Holy automated purchase, Tim. The Joker's placed money in stocks in the school's vending machines.
The dastardly fiend. We have to stop him, Paul, before he corrupts the students. But first...
What?
I'm going to go buy a Dr. Pepper. Do you want anything?
To the bat poles!
Welcome to the Bat Poles, 200 episodes, holy bat audio encyclopedia. This is Tim in Tokyo with my brother Paul in Hanover, New Hampshire.
How's it going, eh?
In honor of our 200th episode, we brought back a favorite bat theme version from the archives previously used in episode 50 from the YouTube channel Kazombie, a Wurlitzer 145B band organ playing Hefty's Batman theme. Elsewhere on the same channel, the 145B and other similar contraptions play the Addams Family theme, Stars and Stripes Forever, It's a Small World, and much more. This Wurlitzer 145B band organ runs on a player piano type role and includes drums, cymbals, and a xylophone. Wikipedia says that the Wurlitzer company started producing mechanical organs after the U.S. government imposed high import tariffs on street and fairground organs in 1892. Hmm. Wurlitzer stopped making band organs in 1939, but continued to manufacture the paper music rolls through a wholly owned subsidiary called the Endless Roll Music Company.
Wholly owned subsidiary!
Yeah, so I know this one always just has stuck in my mind as a favorite of all the different theme versions we've used.
Yes, and after a while, boy, do they melt together. but this one doesn't melt into all the others, like the 400 Dick Dale,
ventures,
homages and ventures homages that we've seen. Seen or heard, many from Japan, right? Because is pretty popular as a kind of garage band genre in Japan.
Yeah, and all the versions that started out with the fake Adam West saying to the Batmobile, "Let's go."
Yeah.
Okay, so in episode 25, we talked about Batman the movie. In episode 145, we discussed Lorenzo Semple Jr.'s screenplay for that movie. This time, we're talking about the novelization of the movie, entitled, confusingly, Batman vs. the Fearsome Foursome, written by Winston Lyon, real name William Woolfolk, first printing August 1966. In episode 98, we talked about Winston Lyon's other Batman book from April 66, Batman versus the Three Villains of Doom.
So Winston Lyon, who wrote the novelization of the film and also the other novel that Tim just mentioned, died only in 2003. So about 20 years ago now, only 2003 seems very near, nearer than it actually is. According to his obits in the LA Times from, his death, he died on July 20th of 2003. He was a comic book writer. He wrote Batman, Superman, Captain Marvel, in the Golden Age. Right after World War II ended, he is apparently responsible for, And this is a quote from encyclopedia.com, inventing the expression holy moly for Captain Marvel to say. By the 50s, he was no longer writing comics. That was kind of, you know, the moment at which the bottom dropped out of the market, thanks in large part to Dr. Wortham, our good friend. Seduction of the Innocent and all that. But he turned to writing genre novels like Criminal Court in 1966. And then he also, of course, wrote Three Villains of Doom and Fearsome Foursome in 66. Then he continued to write until his final novel, 1982. No, 84, The Adam Project. Not the Adam West Project, but the Adam Project. So just a little bit of information about him. He was not a novelist who wrote lots and lots and lots of film and television novelizations like Alan Dean Foster, let's say, I think George Kahn is his name, who wrote the Return of the Jedi novelization, and also wrote quite a number of others. And here's a little information on the novelization of films, which goes back a really, really long time. In fact, it goes back to before the days of film. According to some sources I've found, even in the 17th century, plays were novelized for those who couldn't afford to go to the theater. Although back in those days, you know, in England, certainly going to the theater was not that expensive if you sat in the peanut gallery at the Globe, for example. I'm not sure I'd want to call those novelizations, though, because the novel was just getting started as a mass market form. Well, mass market is a very different thing in the 17th century than it is even a couple of centuries later. But, you know, Don Quixote is from the 17th century, but it was something of an anomaly. And as novels began to, you know, kind of grow some force as entertainment for the upper classes, it also gained a pretty tawdry reputation for giving away too much of, you know, the personal and the private, even though they're fictional characters, you know, personal and private lives being addressed and presented. So by the 18th century in England, certainly, the novel was kind of up and running form. But play adaptations in the form of novels were marketed and, you know, cross-tied in, all of that stuff, you know, even in those days. The first novelization I've been able to find, and it is, you know, kind of well known as an example of a novelization of an American sound film, is King Kong. The novel was published a year before the film was released. So the first, you know, published mention of King Kong is, in fact, in the novelization. However, interestingly, it's impossible to get much information off the web about something that film historians know a great deal about, which is Photoplay magazine and other fan magazines that published what they called novelizations of screenplays of films that were already popular. And so Photoplay would hire someone to distill the script of a blockbuster or a hit film into a novel form or short story form, really, and publish it within the pages of Photoplay. So this goes back to the mid-1910s. So, you know, I consider those novelizations, even if they were novelettes in terms of length. So it's been going on for a long time. And while novelizations have a kind of terrible reputation, especially when, say, a Stephen King novel gets adapted into a film and then somebody else writes the novelization of the film, which has happened. It's happened a lot. I mean, The Spy Who Loved Me, I believe, you know, Ian Fleming had written a story or maybe a novel called The Spy Who Loved Me, but it had nothing to do with the story of the film, as is often the case in James Bond quote-unquote adaptations of Ian Fleming's work. So a novelization had to be written by someone else. MGM couldn't just, and the Broccoli Company couldn't just get the novel by Ian Fleming republished with poster art from the film as a way of cross-marketing a written version of the story.
Because it was a completely different story.
It was a completely different story. So the companies that be involved in the production of the film hired somebody else to write the novelization of the film and then retitled it James Bond, comma, The Spy Who Loved Me, so that it wouldn't compete with or, you know, be mistaken for or infringe on the copyright of the novel itself. You know, the Ian Fleming estate would have gotten pretty hot and bothered if the name had been, the title had been exactly the same as the Ian Fleming story. So, despite all of that, Star Wars fans in particular are giant fans, it seems, of novelizations of the various films, often because they will give more information that gets skipped over or, you know, just implied by the films themselves. And sometimes that information is taken from the original script, which is then like rewritten or adjusted on the set because of directorial input or producer input. Or even actor input. Tim and I've talked about the Star Wars comic book adaptation, which was also, you know, Roy Thomas based that on an earlier draft of the script. So there's, you know, stuff, scenes that ended up being cut later on, some of which actually exist in celluloid form and are circulated on the Blu-rays of the special edition of Star Wars.
Yeah, or the Yoda character design that they used in the Empire Strikes Back adaptation looked quite different from the Muppet.
Yes, he was, how to describe it, he looked sort of like, boy, what's the name of that sprite character from the Harry Potter films?
Don't ask me. I don't know Harry Potter at all.
Anyway, he looks like that guy in drag. And he's purple. The Yoda from Al Williamson's version of Yoda from the original Empire Strikes Back adaptation looks like that character in drag. So, yeah, and didn't you mention there was a lot of, you know, Biggs stuff in the Star Wars comic book adaptation by Roy Thomas and Howard Chaykin?
Yeah, and we were like, who's this Biggs guy? He wasn't in the movie, but he was in the script. And I think that, did they even shoot some of those scenes?
Oh, yeah. Like I said, some of those scenes, or I think a couple of those scenes at least are available. They circulate on the Blu-rays of the special edition as extras. And yeah, but Biggs does show up in the final run of on the Death Star. But when Luke looks so sad when Biggs gets blown up by a TIE fighter, it doesn't mean anything to viewers of the film who haven't read either the comic book or the novelization, which, by the way, was not written by George Lucas, even though his name is on the cover. It was an Alan Dean Foster production.
Anyway, so yeah, I mentioned that the first printing on this book, Fearsome Foursome, is August 66. The film, of course, premiered July 30th, 66 in Austin, Texas. It didn't go to general release until later in August. Actually, back in episode 198, the Bat audio clip was from some of the interviews that were done in Austin on that date. And Dozier says there, the release dates.
First public showing will be this afternoon.
Yes, right. And then does it open simultaneously all over the country, or how is it planned?
No, it opens this month, or August, all over the country. In New York, the 24th, and Chicago, the 26th, and Los Angeles, the 31st. But it opens what they call multiple situations every place.
So most likely the book was on the stands before most people had a chance to see the movie. And, of course, as we were just talking about with Star Wars and other things, in order to get the book out in a timely way, they had to base this book on the script rather than the film. So you see some of the things that were cut in the final film, but we saw in the script there and here, too. Like the Major Terry scene that featured Sterling Holloway, which apparently was shot but not used. And, yeah, a number of other things that are in the script, in the book, not in the film.
It's kind of a shame that, did you say it was Sterling Holloway?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. Kind of a shame it didn't make it. It would have been great to see and hear Winnie the Pooh as a military muckety-muck. Yeah, so things like the Alien adaptation, the original 1979 film's adaptation by Alan Dean Foster. Apparently, Foster didn't even get to look at the alien. He had no idea what the alien looked like. Nobody at the studio would show him any photos or even drawings of the design of the alien. So he just pretty much had to make it up as he went along. But the main difference between most novelizations and the films is kind of, you know, interior thoughts of the characters being used to kind of not just pad out the novel and make sure it hits the 60,000 word kind of lower limit for novelizations, which does seem to be pretty, you know, a pretty accurate number in terms of number of words per adaptation. All novelizations seem to be about the same width, unless the characters are, you know, the typeface is bigger or smaller, then, you know, it's a few pages either way. But the kind of, you know, fleshing out of characters and their relationships, the fleshing out of characters' thoughts and motivations at various moments, people enjoy that. So while in the past I've thought, you know, the main reason we liked having the comic book around of Star Wars was not because we thought it was a good comic book, but because it was another way to experience the film when we didn't have access to it.
Yeah, in the pre-home video days.
Exactly. But the more I read around into the history of novelizations, the less I think that's the case. I think that for many people, it becomes, you know, part of the experience of the film, and it actually just kind of thickens it. So I'm not sure, though, that Winston Lyon does that for us with the novelization.
Well, we certainly do see him padding it out. You know, some scenes become much longer than they were in the film.
Exactly, yeah.
Now, another thing from the script that was changed in the film but not changed in the book is that the villains kidnap Commander Redhead of Schlepp's Whiskey Company. Mm-hmm. And as we mentioned in episode 145, Commander Edward Whitehead was a former British naval officer who became president of Schlepp's American operations in 1953 and appeared in their marketing in the 50s and 60s. And Dozier had found out that Whitehead objected to the idea of being parodied in the movie. So they changed him to Commodore Schmidlap, owner of the Big Bend Distillery, so to reduce the resemblance to Commander Whitehead. So did anything stick out to you in comparing this book to the film or the script?
Well, the first thing that stands out for me, this is completely out of order, is that there really is, you know, even though Batman holding the bomb over his head is on the cover of the copies of the novel that you and I both have, it's a yellow cover, Batman and the Fearsome Foursome, with a color photo of the kind of a medium shot of Batman with a bomb over his head, and then a black and white photo of Robin, kind of smaller and up by Batman's left elbow.
Yeah, riding the sidecar of the Batcycle.
Right, but you know, even though that scene is on the front cover, and became, I don't know how quickly, but certainly now it's one of the most famous and you know, kind of enjoyed and gift scenes in the film. It's not very funny in the novel, and it's hard to see how it could have been.
Well,
because what's funny about that scene is the repetition of Batman running into the nuns and running into the school kids. And while Lyon tries to describe all of that, it's visual humor. It's kind of, you know, slapstick physical comedy that just can't really be adapted to a novelization. So I don't blame Lyon. It's just kind of a letdown, especially with him on the cover with the bomb itself.
And as we talked about before, Martinson really made that scene because he took the can't get rid of a bomb line from Semple's stage directions. It wasn't actually a line that Semple had given to Batman.
Right. Some days you just can't get rid of a bomb.
And so, of course, Lyon didn't pick out that line from the stage direction, so it's not in the book.
Right.
Which might be disappointing to someone who was expecting it there.
Yes, as a first time novelizer, maybe only time novelizer of a screenplay, he was probably sticking pretty closely to the rules. And of course, he'd never seen the film. So why would you turn a piece of stage direction into a line of dialogue?
Well, although he does that at other places in the book.
Oh, really?
For example, now my notes are kind of a mess as usual, but on page 24.
Mm-hmm.
So it's where Quetch is outside of Schmidlap's porthole window, making the sounds and smells of being at sea, even though they're not at sea. And the script mentions that, Quetch is like a regular one-man band, and Lyon has him say to Joker, "I feel like a one-man band." Although having a dialogue there between Joker and Quetch about what Quetch is doing seems like a bad idea, because surely Schmidlap could hear him through the window saying, "I'm faking out Schmidlap by making him think we're at sea." So that's a place where he does do that. But yeah, he didn't do it with "Can't Get Rid of a Bomb."
I could actually see that happening in the film, though. I mean, the Batman television show was never all that careful about things like doing stage whispers for lines that weren't supposed to be heard by, people on the other side of a door or a wall.
Yeah. "It's the Clock King. He's here in Wayne Manor."
Exactly. Goodness gracious me.
So, yeah, I did a lot of comparison of the book and the script. And I'm going to link to the script from the show notes. Unfortunately, I don't have an electronic copy of the book to link to, so sorry about that. But maybe by the end of this podcast, you'll feel as if you've read the book. Of course, you know the story already, presumably.
That's right.
But yeah, I took notes and then I color-coded them to different categories of kind of discussion here. So there were a number of places where he changed the sequence of scenes in order to, I think, reduce the number of scene changes, because, I think that works better in a film than it does in a novel.
Mm-hmm.
Like in the naval battle between Batman and Robin and the villains, there's a lot of back and forth there, a short scene on the bat boat, a short scene in the sub, back and forth. And Lyon, in some places, he'll just cut out one side's point of view and stay in one place. It still flows fine, I think. But, yeah, you're not jumping back and forth so much. And there were a number of places like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've got way too many examples in my notes here to talk about all of them. We'd be here, rival Gone with the Wind in length. And we may still anyway, but
we've already done that with the serials, which certainly deserved that kind of treatment.
Yeah, but, or tut. I have a couple of examples in my notes. There might have been some others that I missed. For some reason, Lyon is interested in Batman's precision and speed. On page 9, he mentions that this is really early in the movie, from coming up the Wayne Manor driveway to being on the Batcopter, it only took them 6 minutes. Like, I don't think so. I don't care if he is Batman.
Right.
If the Batcopter pad were, in the Batcave, sure, but...
Yeah. Well, it's kind of hilarious the way in which the various devices of Batman and Robin's arsenal get described here, because, you and I and our listeners all know just how poorly the actual Batmobile performed on the set and how slow the darn thing was. And yet, Lyon gives us these long excursies about what a magnificent machine it is, and how it would have left, Formula One cars in the dust.
Yeah. All you got to do is undercrank the camera.
That's right. It's very easily done, and you don't even have to tune up your engine. But of course, you know, the fictional Batmobile, we would have been, you know, we would have lapped that up if we'd read what Lyon claims about it. And we believed it because under cranking the camera, man. but it's just, you know, between that and the way that Batman's, you know, speed and meticulousness get described, it does feel like padding.
Another example I had. So, of course, in the script, Semple envisioned the Batboat being in this shack. And, of course, that's not what they ended up with in the movie. But the shack is in the book, and Lyon writes, as they're heading out to sea in the Batboat, "From the laconic tone of his conversation with Robin in the cockpit, one would never have guessed that they were traveling at speeds far beyond any ever attained by the swiftest ocean-going craft." So there's the speed again. I guess being Batman is all about speed for him.
That must be how they, you know, maintain themselves during those long, long nights in the Batcave doing lab work. Lots and lots of speed. Oops. Family show.
Another category I had was Lyon and Martinson, Leslie Martinson, director of the film, correcting Semple, where both of them caught something that Semple didn't think of, overlooked. Yeah, this one strikes me as kind of odd in the script, but when Kitka tells Bruce that they seem to be being held as bait for Batman, when they're in the hideout, you know, on the bed, Semple has Penguin say, "Drat the woman, she's spilling the beans," and Riddler says, "One more slip and she'll be sorry." Neither Lyon nor Martinson included that, and I think it was good to get rid of. It doesn't really make any sense to me. I mean, why is that spilling the beans? I think she's just, you know, it's maybe a little hint of information, but it wouldn't give away that she's Catwoman or anything, I don't think.
Right. Yeah. Forgivable, but a little odd.
Are you addicted to classic TV shows? Did you spend the 80s sitting in front of the boob tube? Then join us for TV Tangents, where we examine television of the 20th century with barely any contemporary context. Visit Shout Engine, Apple Podcasts, Google Play, or wherever you get your podcasts, and look for TV Tangents.
Do you like comics? The 1960s? How about middle-aged gay couples gossiping about their neighbors? Then you'll love Checkered Past.
A loving examination of DC's Go-Go Check branded comic magazines published from February 1966 to August 1967.
I'm Dr. Bob.
And I'm Dr. Husband.
And each week we'll be your hosts on a trippy tour through mid-century four-color madness. Checkered Past. Available wherever fine podcasts are downloaded for free.
Okay, this one's kind of weird. So at the United World, you know, when the other three villains arrive and meet up with Penguin, and they tell him that, you know, they think they've killed Batman in the film, but that was not in the script.
Right.
Now, Lyon doesn't think to have them tell Penguin that either, but both Lyon and Martinson have the villains react when Batman and Robin show up at the United World. But that's not in the script either. You know, they just kind of, oh, it's Batman. We're not surprised at all.
That's right.
But yeah, so Lyon is kind of weird because it kind of leaves the question, why is Penguin surprised because they never told him that Batman was dead? But then there's a whole exchange where Joker, Penguin, and Riddler all comment on that Batman should be dead, but here he is. Page 108. At the end of the corridor, heading to the abandoned elevator, they saw the four supercriminals. "Surrender, you criminals!" The four supercriminals halted in a frozen instant of surprise as the familiar, all too familiar voice rang out. "That does sound like Batman, doesn't it?" the Riddler asked. "The United Underworld is through," Robin shouted. "And that sounds like Robin," said the Joker. "But it can't be, because they're dead." "By the sainted Dodo," cried the Penguin, looking around, "they're alive!" in the movie, Penguin says, "Faw, what's this, an apparition?"
Right, right.
But, yeah, there's no reaction in the script.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there are several other examples like that. Then I had the category Lyon, quote, correcting, unquote, Semple's, quote, mistakes, unquote.
I like.
I've got this one coded as that, but it's more just a complete slip up on Lyon's part.
Mm.
On page 23, Commander Redhead said, now this is not in the film or the script, but I think Lyon must have been thinking that Redhead should explain a little bit more what's going on to connect it with later in the book. But he says he's planning to offer his invention to the United Nations.
Yeah.
But it's United World later in the book, you know, in the places where it's mentioned in the movie.
That's right.
But yeah, I don't know if he must have just forgotten at that point that it wasn't the United Nations by name.
Yeah. I mean, I could just imagine him having written United Nations over and over again and then having to go back through what the draft of the novel and cross out, you know, nation and write world instead.
No search and replace on a typewriter.
Absolutely. And this might be, you know, the one that he missed. So he probably did better than we might imagine from seeing this mistake.
So the script has Bruce telling Alfred directly to meet him in the Batcave after seeing out Miss Kitka. Now, the book only has him asking Alfred to see her out. And then in the Batcave, Batman tells Robin to call Alfred down. And I don't know, maybe Lyon was thinking that Semple's way Kitka might overhear him saying, you know, come meet me in the Batcave. You know, you wouldn't want that to happen. An interesting addition that he made. So in the film, Batman says Bruce Wayne will go out on the town with Miss Kitka. In the book, page 47, he goes on with, "The moment I decoded the Riddler's message, which was while Miss Kitka was showing it to me, I decided that I must act as her guardian. Bruce Wayne will go out on the town with Miss Kitka. In fact, he will become her almost constant companion." So, I mean, I guess a justification for that would be thinking that just going out on a date with someone isn't enough to really protect them if their life is in danger.
Right, right. In general, though, Lyon portrays Bruce Wayne / Batman as completely gaga over Miss Kitka. He seems irrational compared to his usual, you know, extremely, you know, well-controlled self.
Right. Well, I've got that in a different category of notes here.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I wanted to be sure to mention this one. When Batman and Robin arrive at the United World building, in the script and the film, they demand that the ventilation system be turned off to avoid blowing the dehydrated delegates around. In the book, page 108, Lyon has them think of turning it on in order to get rid of the Penguin's gas. And then saying, "No, wait, that would be bad." So I'm thinking that Lyon might have been thinking if the ventilation system were already on, it would be too late to save the delegates, which makes sense, except why would the ventilation system be off?
Right. That did cross my mind as well.
It makes sense except for that.
Yeah, you think of that as just a permanent on and kind of a no-brainer.
Mm-hmm, right.
Otherwise, everybody would be dying of Legionnaire's disease. But, of course, that hadn't even been diagnosed before or invented as a name for a syndrome.
Okay, now I really want to get to this category, which I called cut camp / un-Batman-like.
Okay.
So, yeah, you mentioned that he's so gaga over Miss Kitka, you know, to the point where, yeah, when he's talking about her in the Batcave, he just kind of spaces out at one point, and Alfred kind of snaps him out of it, and he's like, "What?" Page 47. Won't she think it rather odd, sir, if Batman accompanies her whenever she goes out? It won't be Batman who will accompany her, replied the Caped Crusader. Bruce Wayne will go out on the town with Miss Kitka. In fact, he will become her almost constant companion. Alfred's eyes twinkled. A not displeasing chore, sir. I've seen the young lady. Batman smiled. Indeed, Alfred, I've rarely met a girl who is such a potent argument in favor of international relations. In fact, he paused, losing the thread of what he was saying as reverie overtook him. He remembered Miss Kitka's melting brown eyes, the sinuous lines of her gorgeous body, the dimple in her alabaster cheek. You were saying, sir? What? Robin said. Batman, what's the matter? Oh, yes. With an effort, Batman recovered. And that's just, you cannot imagine Adam West Batman or any Batman acting that way about a woman, because crime fighting is the most important thing. And even worse, page 109. So this is, yeah, when right after the villains see that Batman and Robin are not dead at the United World, the scene is really extended in the book. Like it's a couple of pages, and there's a bit of a bat fight there and everything. Mm-hmm. And Catwoman gives more details on her threat against Miss Kitka's life. And Batman actually can't decide whether fighting the villains is more important than his romance with Miss Kitka.
And right,
that just,
right.
I just didn't buy that at all. I mean, he's Batman. I wrote in my notes, all caps with a period. He's Batman. Nothing is higher priority than fighting crime, not even romance.
Well, of course, if someone's life is at stake, maybe it would be different. When on 109, Catwoman says, I think you'd better let us go, Batman. Why should I? Batman demanded as he began to close in on her. Because if you don't, Miss Kitka dies, in italics. Batman, in the act of striding forward, suddenly stopped. His body became rigid with indecision. What, you feline fiend? What are you saying? Simply this, Batman. We left Miss Kitka under guard. Our instructions to the guard are that if we fail to return within the hour, she must be put to death. Do you want an innocent girl's death on your conscience, Batman? So it's not just a question of, like, losing her being, a hit to his romantic life. Mm-hmm. It's that we've got an innocent life at stake, although, as it turns out, this life is far from innocent because she's Catwoman. Miss Kitka is also Catwoman, but we know that, obviously, as readers. Batman just doesn't know it. So I would say that, you know, the Batman we know from the show might, in fact, decide that the life of an innocent is more important than, taking care of business at the United World.
Yeah, I mean, Robin steps in and says, Batman, it's up to you to decide, but remember, the Security Council, our only hope for the peace of the world, gone. Mm-hmm. Batman says, you're right, Robin.
Yeah, and that makes sense, too, the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few, said Mr. Spock. That makes sense. But it's, you know, this is the biggest choice between one innocent life and many, many, many innocent lives that we've ever seen Batman make. It's, you know, much more bombastic and, you know, universal than any of those, you know, tough decisions that Batman has ever made in the series itself. Stakes are a lot higher.
So I mentioned cut camp. So a lot of the, like, funniest lines of the movie, Lyon does away with them.
Mm-hmm.
So the shark incident, the beginning. Now, of course, you can't see the rubber shark, so that loses a lot of the humor. But I mean, it doesn't mention the other repellent sprays. Later, page 18, we don't see all the goofy connections from the script that convince Batman and Robin and the GCPD that all four crooks are involved. Like, it happened at sea. C for Catwoman. You know, that's all gone. When Batman and Robin are on the buoy, in the script, Batman says, the fiends, they've converted this buoy into a gigantic magnet. It's got us by the metallic objects we're wearing. And Lyon only writes, they've converted this buoy into a gigantic magnet.
Okay.
And he doesn't have the batteries in Batman's device dying. He doesn't have the porpoise that sacrificed itself. He doesn't have the Admiral playing tiddlywinks with a gorgeous wave. Although he does give the Admiral a name, Admiral Jettison.
Which is kind of campy and funny.
Yeah, it works. It fits in with the tone of Batman 66. But then the line about Batman saying he's a taxpayer and could possibly charge the Admiral with the greatest laxity, he only says that to Robin after he hangs up the phone. He doesn't say it to the Admiral like he does in the script and the film.
Yes.
Was Lyon thinking maybe this was too disrespectful to an Admiral? I don't know. Batman wouldn't do that.
Well, Batman will school anyone,
civic responsibility, Batman.
Yes, and anyone on the 66 show, even an admiral, would accept Batman's, scorn, or in this case, just reprimand, the reprimanding tone.
Or when they're solving the riddles that Kitka delivered, and Robin concludes that the two riddles mean someone Russian will slip on a banana peel and bust their neck if they reveal the strange big thing on ice. And in the script and the film, Batman says that's the only possible meaning, and that's not in the book either.
Robin, listen to these riddles. Tell me if you interpret them as I do. One, what has yellow skin and writes?
A ballpoint banana.
Right. Two, what people are always in a hurry?
Russian people? Russians!
Right again. Now, what would you say they mean?
Banana? Russian. I've got it! Someone Russian is gonna slip on a banana peel and break their neck!
Precisely, Robin. The only possible meaning.
Yes. Oh, what a missed opportunity.
I mean, he just cuts all of these really... some of our favorite lines from the movie are gone from this book.
That's right. The things that, give every Batman 66 fan probably even more pleasure than the bat fights and the action, sometimes by quite a long shot. But I wonder if Lyon had ever seen the show.
You wonder.
Yeah, exactly. You would think that would be basic research material for writing a screenplay of a film, or writing a novelization of a screenplay of a film taken from a television show.
And Batman's bat climb speech about rum pots is gone.
That's a shame. Yes.
And on and on. Yeah.
Well, I don't know if this is the right place to bring up the fact that the novel, when Bruce and Kitka are together, becomes softcore. It's at least PG-13, I would say.
They kiss a lot more than they do in the film.
Oh, for sure. And then Bruce has this dream, or the daydream, that he's the vision of her that he's kind of sponsoring for himself, because Kitka's asked him to keep his eyes closed because she's, going to do something surreptitious. She's going to contact her villainous gang with a tiny radio transmitter. This is 54 and 55. But she comes back after sending a Morse code signal with a jeweled cat's tail on the transmitter. And then this is 55. Bruce Wayne stirred. The dream continues, he said. Dear, dear Miss Kitka. Da, da, she answered, keeping a wary eye on him while she tapped out the message. It approaches a climax. Bruce Wayne's eyes fluttered.
But that's in the film.
Oh, yes, yes, I know. it's just that, reading it and then, seeing the descriptions, quite a few descriptions of her, her gorgeous body with this, the sheer negligee grabbing her curves,
her that lissome curves. Yes.
Yes. And that's another thing. One needs to pad up your novelization to 60,000 words. So be sure you add many more adjectives and adverbs than are ever possibly necessary. just chuck them in there and load them up and pile them up. Three or four in a sentence is not a bad thing. But, I know that the climactic moment is in the film, but I think the way that it's narrated here, you know, suggests that he might actually be having a dream that is rather damp, let's say.
Yeah. Yeah, he's getting served milk and cookies in the dream.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's why he's licking his lips. I got it. Oh, boy. Yes, that's hot stuff. Yeah, I'm thinking maybe, you know, PG-13 would be, obviously PG-13 didn't exist in the 1960s as a rating, but I'm thinking even that would be a little tame, a little too tame for the content we're seeing here. If only Lee Merriweather, you know, for, you know, the dirty old man market, if only Lee Merriweather had actually worn this sheer negligee in the film. And maybe she does, but certainly it's not as revealing as Lyon makes it out to be.
It's a pink bathrobe in the film. There's no black negligee anywhere.
Is it like a My Little Pony robe or, you know, maybe strawberry shortcake to appeal to the kids? Neither of which product existed in 1966, of course.
In the film, you see a bit of leg, but that's about it. But, you know, if it were like what Lyon writes, I don't think it would have been for general audiences.
Definitely not. Definitely not. Yeah, I mean, there's still the problem of the script itself that Batman doesn't recognize that Kitka and Catwoman are the same person.
Right. Well, they don't recognize that Batman and Bruce Wayne are the same person either. Well, right? It makes sense that it works both ways. Although, of course, they immediately recognize Penguin disguised as Schmidlap.
Well, the nose gives it away. Yes, and the continual racking that it's, you know, impossible for clearly impossible for Burgess Meredith, let alone the Penguin, to, you know, to arrest. One last thing to say about the seduction scene, if that's what this is that, you know, the climactic, you know, the moment of where the moment of climax, good grief, the moment at which Bruce says, you know, it's reached a climax or it's reaching a climax is camp the way it's delivered and staged in the movie, because, you know, it seems kind of arch. It seems sort of like a, you know, suave, you know, wry, clever thing that Bruce Wayne is saying, and he seems to be, you know, almost sponsoring the line rather than reading it. You know, it's like climax in quotation marks, as our, you know, old saw about camp goes. But in the context of the scenes that the steamy scenes that Lyon writes, once again, the, you know, the camp has been decamped.
Mm-hmm. Lyon's vision of Batman is not Semple's. And he's seems to be cutting out the most Semplean parts.
It seems the novel is actually written for the 8-year-olds rather than for the for the 30, 40, and 50-year-olds for which the, you know, the show was always double pitched to kids and to adults simultaneously.
You kind of picture Lyon as somebody who was a fan of the early Batman and reading the script and saying, "That's not Batman."
Mm-hmm. Well, let's not forget that Lyon was not only probably a fan of that earlier Batman, he actually wrote some Batman stories in the end of the 1940s and probably up to the early 50s.
Yeah, just some other weird stuff. At the end of the movie, the end of the book, Lyon has Batman and Robin swinging from their bat ropes. They throw their batarangs over to another building and swing away. Which is easy to do in prose, but to have actors do is a whole other thing.
Right.
I mean, I could go on and on, like I said, about all the differences that I found. I noticed that in the script, the heavy water incident in the Batcave, Semple has it set at heavy from the start. And then, of course, Martinson has Penguin's water tube accidentally pull it over. Lyon doesn't even mention that setting until after the henchmen have disappeared.
Mm.
So then, at that point, then Batman says, "Oh, it must have been mixed with heavy water." But yeah, there's no indication of the heavy water beforehand.
Right. Well, what other categories do you have? Have you collected some examples under?
Well, there were a couple of things that I called Lyon insights. Just a couple of, there were only a couple of things that I kind of notice that I thought were interesting. Early on, he mentions that there had been a party of picnickers near the Batcave, and, you know, unaware that the Batcave was, like, right under them or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And then I liked later on in the book, page 111, he refers to Joker's startlingly green shirt, which I kind of liked. Yeah, another adjective, startlingly green shirt. I was noticing the United World delegates, because there's some confusion both in the script and the book, I think. Mm-hmm. Well, the script and the book both mention that, you know, at the end when their languages are mixed up, that the Englishman is speaking Russian and the Frenchman is speaking German. Mm-hmm. Semple says the American is speaking Chinese, even though there's no Chinese delegate.
Yeah, I mean, the nations all get listed for us.
Lyon has the American speaking Albanian. There's no Albanian delegate either. Martinson or somebody in working on the movie seems to have been stuck sorting it out, because, like, there's no, as far as I could find, there's no character list, certainly not in the script PDF that we have anyway.
That's right.
So, you know, the script doesn't ever list all of the nine nations in this United World. The movie gives us an American, a Brit, a Japanese, a German, a Russian, a Spaniard, a Nigerian, a Frenchman, and an Israeli,
mm-hmm.
which is quite a bit more diverse than the real Security Council.
yes, that's true.
But yeah, no Chinese and no Albanians.
Could be Albanian, could be Ukrainian, could be the alien. Send it to me. Sorry, Old Stone songs, deep cuts, deep tracks.
By the way, I'm wondering, like, why are the delegates all yelling at each other when they're all saying how important peace is? They're not having any disagreements because mm-hmm. they're all saying the same thing. And it's not a warlike position.
No. But what they're doing is a campy, version of how people in general imagine politics. Because we usually hear about the disagreements much more, loudly and continuously than we do agreements, especially when it comes to world politics. So it seems almost like a parody of the kind of received knowledge about, what happens at the UN. I mean, we're not that far away from Khrushchev, pounding the table with his shoe and saying, "We will bury you."
Right. Well, we've got a reference to the shoe in the movie.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And in the novel.
Mm-hmm. By the way, I realized that in the script, Semple seems to envision all nine of the delegates being dehydrated simultaneously.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, in the film, and I think in the book, well, I'm not sure what the book says, but in the film, of course, Joker dehydrates them one by one. And mm-hmm. curiously, nobody notices.
What about Joker's startlingly green shirt?
Yeah, they
notice that.
They're so involved in their yelling about peace that they don't notice four supervillains walking in, or they're disintegrating the delegates one by one. They just keep yammering on.
It's a good thing they weren't. This wasn't the Security Council. They would definitely not be worthy of their positions.
Anyway, but I mean, overall, it is like reading the movie, even though the campiest lines are gone.
Yeah, and the bickering between the supervillains and just the kind of tension and energy between them as they perform. There's no way that you could get the acting into the novel. It's just not what novels do.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel as though, and I didn't go back and watch the film to see, what the correlation is between exact lines in the film and Semple's script. But those scenes just seem to be like linking scenes that Lyon is trying to get through as quickly as possible.
Hmm.
But again, so much of the tension and the fun of those bickering scenes among the villains comes from the performances and our, knowledge of the actors.
Right. I was noticing, I did watch most of the movie too. I was kind of like pause the movie and read the script and read the book and then go back to the movie. And you know, in the sub, they tell Riddler to send out messages, to, ransom messages, I think, to the nine countries, and mm-hmm. not include any stupid riddles. And you know, Joker says make the messages clear. Penguin says that again, and then. Unique to the movie, not in the script, not in the book. Well, sorry, kind of in the book, but it's not in the script. Joker repeats, make those messages clear. And then there's this look between Romero and Gorshin. And then they both start laughing really aggressively. It's such a great, great moment that, yeah, there's no way you can replicate that in the book.
Delightful.
Mr. Riddler, will you kindly prepare those nine radio ransom messages?
All right, all right. And none of your stupid riddles, do you understand? Make those messages plain.
$1 billion cash from each country.
Precisely, Mr. Riddler. To be delivered to our secret island by the horde of trained carrier pigeons, which I shall presently provide. But no whimsical embellishments, please. Make those messages clear.
Make those messages clear.
Yes, it's a laugh-off between the world's most villainous laughers.
In the book, yeah, Lyon does have Joker repeat that, or some version of make those messages clear, and Riddler says, spoil sport.
Mm-hmm.
Which is okay, but yeah, it's not nearly as funny as the scene in the film.
Yeah, and you know, rather than spoil sport, I can think of, you know, five different very, very loquacious insults that that the Riddler could have, you know, lodged or lobbed him at that point.
It's not a very good Batman 66 line.
No.
It's not for a supervillain.
No, it just seems like a contemptuous pout rather than a, you know, high horse moment of, you know, proclaiming his superiority. Although Riddler does do that in the novel at one point. He does, you know, show the Riddler ego that we all enjoy so much in Gorshin's performance.
Oh, I have one more cut camp scene, page 113. So Semple has had Batman say that he looked up the missile's broadcast frequency this morning. It just offhandedly says, you know, he's already looked it up ahead of time, which is, you know, such a simple camp Batman 66 gag.
For sure. But
Lyon's not having it. Instead, he has Batman and Robin switch seats in the Batboat. And so here, once again, we have Robin driving.
Yep.
And Batman does calculations on paper while Robin is driving. But I'm not sure how you would figure out the missile's broadcast frequency with math.
Yeah. Well, remember, math does a lot of strange things that non-mathematicians and statisticians just don't, you know, would never fathom or expect. Nevertheless, it does seem a little incautious, I suppose, in describing it that way when, you know, their audience might be a bit broader than they expect.
WhenItWasCool.com is your source for the best in retro pop culture. When It Was Cool features articles and podcasts on retro TV and movies, toys, action figures, pro wrestling, food, video games, and more. Hit the Patreon button to support us and get instant access to hundreds of premium podcasts and features. Family friendly and fun. WhenItWasCool.com.
Hello, I'm Ken Holzhauser, and if you're looking for something new in comic books, may I recommend my newest comic, The Quick and the Dad, a love letter to the DC, Marvel, Archie, and Harvey comics of my youth. This comic has everything. It has spaceships, dad jokes, alien invasions, time travel, supervillains, and so many bad puns. Hopefully you'll like it. It's the cutest comic you've never heard of, and it's available today in print and digital from IndiePlanet.com. That's The Quick and the Dad. Join that other dynamic duo, won't you?
Coming up, Cesar Romero interviewed by Jean Boone in Austin, Texas, before the premiere of the Batman movie on July 30th, 1966, and we read your mail in the Bat Inbox. This show is listener-supported through Patreon. Join us for $2 a month and get access to outtakes from every To the Bat Poles episode, trivia quiz videos on 20th Century Entertainment, and the right to vote on future Bat Poles topics. For a $4 monthly donation, you also get the right to have an ad for your own project on the show once a month, and hours of exclusive podcasts, including our monthly issue-by-issue walk through the first 50 issues, plus annuals, of The Amazing Spider-Man. So go to patreon.com/deconcomics and select the level of your monthly donation. Thanks for listening and thanks for your support.
I'd like for you to meet Cesar Romero, because under all of this makeup as the Joker in the Batman movie, he is, of course, one of the handsomest actors and men in the world.
Well, you can easily tell that.
I can easily tell. I have a question. Why the green hair on Joker?
Oh, well, that's part of the Joker's makeup, you know.
No, I never
green hair. I'm not a great student, actually, of the Batman comic strip, but I understand that the Joker got the green hair because in one of the first strips that he appeared in making his escape from Batman, he dove into a river that was full of a certain chemical that turned his hair green. So from then on, he's had green hair.
It's ridiculous. Do you like playing Joker?
Oh, sure. It's a lot of fun. Yeah. Yes, we have a lot of fun doing the show, and we had a lot of fun making the movie. it's a part, you know, that you can do everything that you've always been told not to do as an actor. In other words, you can get as hammy as you like,
right,
and go all out, and it's great fun. I enjoy it.
What are you doing? Are you doing some film now? Are you doing Broadway?
I've been doing some personal appearances up in Boston and in Oklahoma City, and now in about a week or so, I'm going to do a television special with Red Skelton, and then I have to do a two-part A Man from U.N.C.L.E.
Good.
And then another a Batman television show.
Mm-hmm.
And then in September, I expect to be doing a picture at Paramount.
Very good.
So I'll be kind of busy.
I know it. You started out, I know, as a song and dance man. I remember I've seen you in Ann Southern cutting up. You're still good. Do you dance much?
No.
No. No. You're the best dancer in the world?
No, I'm getting too old.
Oh, you are not.
And it's too much hard work, honey.
No, you're not.
No, really, you know, the last time... You know how old you were when I first met you?
17.
You were 17, you
yes.
see.
Yeah.
And I was, let me see...
18 or 19, I think.
Oh, yes, easily.
Easily. We were well chaperoned, but Cesar happened to be a friend of my sister, and so when I visited her, he had to take care of baby sister and take her every place in Hollywood.
Why, sir?
And you even rode things at Ocean Park, and I think we all got sick riding the rides.
I know, but it was a lot of fun.
I had a wonderful time.
I look back on those years with a lot of sort of nostalgia and whatever you want to call it, but they were fun.
I think so.
They were fun, and I miss them too.
Oh, I do too.
I miss seeing Elaine.
Mm-hmm.
I see her once in a blue moon when I go to New York, and of course she's had a very exciting life.
Yes.
Being married to John Steinbeck, traveling all over the world, it's been a wonderful thing for her.
I think probably you see her more often than I.
No, I don't, Jean, because I don't go to New York very
You're
often.
Really working mainly then in Hollywood.
I stay in California most of the time.
When you're doing your regular Batman for television, how often do you have to work? How often do you work?
Each show. See, I'm not in all the shows,
right.
You know.
Well, sure.
Just now last season I did three of the Batman shows, and then of course the motion picture. And now next month I'll be doing the first one for the new season. How many I'll do, I don't know.
Yeah.
Probably about three or four.
I wish you'd win sometime.
Oh, you can't win. The villain can't win. We always win, you know, on Wednesday night. At the end of the show, Wednesday night, we're winning. But then comes Thursday night, we lose.
You've had it. Had it. You don't care. Oh, well, I've enjoyed talking with you, and we're going to see you in
well,
the movie.
Thank you, dear. It's wonderful
see
to see you again.
Nice to see you. Cesar Romero, of course, a fine actor, and presently starring as Joker in the Batman movie.
Bat Inbox. We are, I still want to call it the Bat Mailbag, maybe in deference to the old Letterman show. Letters, we get letters, we get lots and lots of letters sometimes. Letters, sometimes.
Depends on the topic.
It depends on the topic and the week. So this is from the Batman 66 message board, correct? The all-knowing, all-seeing, yes. I almost missed my cue. So Tim's going to read the first one from Bat 77.
Right, and this is still the discussion of the Adam West, Frank Gorshin, Shea Stadium show.
Right.
So, yes, Bat 77 says, my partner and I moved to New Orleans this year, and we currently live just down the street from City Park Stadium, now known as the Tad Gormley Stadium. Nowadays, it's mainly used to host high school football games on Friday nights, and you can hear the bands, cheers, and announcements from our house. But in its heyday, it hosted a variety of concert acts such as the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, Alice Cooper, the Ramones, ZZ Top, Pearl Jam, and Rage Against the Machine.
In the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s called and want their bands back. Boy, I'd love, I would love to go to some of those concerts. I have seen ZZ Top and the Stones, but that's the only, those are the only ones.
I recently did a photo shoot in City Park in my Batman 66 cosplay. Little did I know that it wasn't the first time that the 66 Batman paid a visit to City Park, because as we talked about in the Bat Inbox last time, Adam West had appeared at City Park back in, what was it, November of 66.
And we had the photo from the local press.
Yeah.
Nice cosplay picture. Wow, that costume is fabulously televisually similar. It's authentic looking. It's a nice costume, and the shading and the camera angle are actually quite professional looking as well. Really cool. Bat 77. Batwinged Hornet writes, hello, Batwinged Hornet. Another deep dive into all things 66 Batman. Good work, guys. Thanks. You know, the Shea Stadium show was a cheap deal. If the organizers would not even rent one of the Batmobiles created for personal appearances in car shows, or the drag race version, to drive Batman out on the field. Some might say the expense to rent one of the Batmobiles, whatever that was, in 1966, was not worth stretching the budget. What budget? But the car had as many fans as the stars of the show, and if advertised as appearing with Batman and the Riddler, it might have attracted more ticket buyers. That's a really good point. You know, I think seeing the Batmobile was nearly, if not actually, as exciting for us as kids in 77 as seeing Adam West.
Mm-hmm. And the Batmobile doesn't tell bad jokes.
Right, right. Although the disappointment, I still remember how disappointed I was that the Batmobile was fuzzy because it was the flocked version of the Batmobile. It's like, you know, I don't want to get lint on the Batmobile. You know, get it away from my laundry. But it was so strange. It's like, it's supposed to be shiny. It's shiny on the show. All of my illusions have been, you know, the balloons have all been popped. Anyway, orange-colored sky. Sheesh, Batwinged Hornet goes on to say. Humans were not provided with ears to endure that. West was so tone-deaf, and you know he was not hamming it up on every verse, so it's just awful. I'm not sure if he, I'm not sure he never ended up on Rhino Records' Golden Throats collection. That would have just been a major oversight. Didn't know about that collection. That must be, you know, the Golden Throats in the ironic sense collection.
Mm.
Guys, Adam West had a noticeable paunch while on the 66 series, which started to show toward the end of season one. I know there's a faction of the 66 fan base who do not like to admit that, but his belly being noticed dates back to the series' first run era, even in the Man-Bat satire, or Batsman, sorry, satire from Mad Magazine, number 105 from September of 66, which we have talked about on this program. And typical of Mort Drucker's legendary ability to zero in on and play up very specific details of an actor's physical appearance, he illustrated West with a paunch, similar to the way he would make a bodybuilder even more bloated with vein-covered muscles, or someone with a pronounced nose now having one the size of a shoe. Sure, I guess I don't know, maybe it's because I was a fat little kid, I'm a little sensitive to, you know, my heroes being said, you know, said to have a paunch. Maybe that's it, but it seems as though, you know, Adam West had a fairly normal body for, you know, an older young man, or, you know, early middle-aged man at the time. What was he? Somewhere in his early to mid-30s at the time.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's what's kind of funny for me in the present about his body is that it just looks like, you know, he's a normal guy who doesn't work out. rather than, you know, being paunchy necessarily. And, you know, people like Mort Drucker are paid to find the slightest, you know, physical imperfection to exaggerate as much as possible. That's how political cartoons work as well. So I'm not really disagreeing with Batwing Hornet here. I'm just saying that, I guess, you know, it's not as funny to me as it must have been to, you know, others, folks looking at him as, you know, not having the Batman body shape ideal, I guess. It's just that, you know, I'm becoming, you know, the body image police now. But, you know, either way, I don't think it's that noticeable. But I do agree that he has one by comparison to, say, Lyle Waggoner, for example.
Yeah. Or anyone playing a hero in the MCU.
Right.
Yes. They've all been working out.
Abs of steel. Yes. Even Natalie Portman now has abs of steel, I'm sure.
So Batwing Hornet goes on. Tim, you imagined if you had been a kid in attendance at the show, you would have been disappointed by the snarky answers to the attendees given by West and Gorshin. And I have to guess that routine probably resulted from two issues. The writers being used to scripting that kind of comedian-to-audience interplay one would see in a comedy club, and the need to allow West and Gorshin to appear as themselves, ego-stroking, instead of characters in, quote, silly, unquote, costumes. In the final analysis, the Shea Stadium show's failure should have tipped off everyone that Batmania had already run its course. Of note is the fact that the live show made its debut on June 25, 1966, a little over a month before the July 30, 1966 premiere of the movie, and considering how both did not perform as expected, everyone involved in the selling of Dozier's Batman should have realized that high mark of interest seen in early 1966 was not going to be recaptured. To be quite honest, by the time the Shea Stadium show debuted, I would have bought a ticket for The Temptations and the Young Rascals. Batman and Riddler? Not so much.
Yeah, the dialogue, or supposedly the kind of call and response with the audience's letters or the notes they supposedly dropped off. I guess they did, but none of them get read in the script. That all feels kind of like something out of a celebrity roast. And Comedy Club, I think, kind of hits it on the nose, that this is the kind of insult comedy that, not really insult comedy, but snarkiness that I think to some degree in comedy clubs is intended to fend off hecklers because, you know, if the comedian is being that snarky to fictional people or to, you know, people who aren't even present, wait till you see what he does to you, buddy, if you step out of line.
So 200 episodes. Oof. And we've learned a lot about Batman 66 in 200 episodes, and we hope you have too. We're thinking we'd like to put the show in a lower gear to go to once every 4 weeks and give ourselves time to work on other projects.
Yes, potentially Batman 66 related that just aren't podcasts.
Right. So we're not ending the show. We would like to finish our series on women in Batman 66 and the casting crossovers with Star Trek. And, of course, there are still scripts out there. I don't know that we've even looked at half the scripts yet.
No, certainly not.
We're wondering how much more there might be to learn. We've covered a lot of topics, and are there more other things that we could investigate? Let us know if you've got an idea.
Well, you know, we found new topics that we had no idea existed since we were contacted about the first Batman 66 fan film, for example.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, some things just fell in our laps, and
that's right.
And Stanford Sherman's letters. One aspect that we haven't looked at closely enough yet is the tie-in merchandise for the show in 1966. So in the next episode, 4 weeks from now, we're going to discuss Chip Kidd's book Batman Collected, which looks at Batman toys not only from 66, but throughout Bat history, related to the comics, the 40s serials, and the later movies.
So get out your Ben Franklin plastic Batman mask with the Batman's insignia on the forehead, with the word Batman emblazoned across it, and wear it while you're listening to the next podcast.
Yeah, and if we find some other information about Bat tie-in merchandise will include that too.
You know, we've been calling it, or I have been calling it, Bat Guano for as many years as there has been Batman 66 to the Bat Poles podcast. So perhaps I will be convinced that it's not all guano by reading Chip Kidd's book and doing a little nosing around elsewhere. Ooh, nosing and guano. I probably shouldn't have put those nouns together. Yeah, anyway, let's not sniff the guano. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll see you in 4 weeks here at the same Bat RSS feed. Check the show notes for the video of the Wurlitzer band organ version of the theme and a link to the screenplay for Batman the Movie. I have absolutely no idea what to use for future Bat audio segments. If you know of any other cast interviews that we haven't used or other Bat-related audio, please let me know at batpoles@deconstructingcomics.com. You can also use that email address to make a donation to the show through PayPal or just to drop us a line. You can also comment on the thread for each episode and each script at 66batman.com/forums or on our blog at tothebatpoles.libsyn.com. We're on Twitter at Decon Comics and on the Deconstructing Comics channel on YouTube. You can hear outtakes from this and every episode of To the Bat Poles and vote for topics for future episodes by supporting us at patreon.com/deconcomics. You can also help us out by shopping via deconstructingcomics.com/Amazon, by sharing our episodes on your social media, and by subscribing to the show on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. And spread the word. Let all your friends who are Batman 66 fans know about the show. Next time, Bat Merch. We discuss Chip Kidd's book, Batman Collected. See you then. To the Bat Poles is a production of DeconstructingComics.com.